Hello and a warm welcome to a new series of Drive-In. Well, a new series, I should say, because we've given the show a whole new look. Tony and I will be joined by some new faces as the series goes on, and we shall be covering the whole motoring scene, bringing you the personalities, the issues, and the cars that matter to motorists at the moment. The most significant new car we expect to come our way in 1977. For the first time, it takes Ford into the mini class, and it will almost certainly help Ford overtake Leyland as market leaders in Britain. So it's an important car. But after all the ballyhoo, does Fiesta actually give the motorist what he's looking for in the 70s? That's what we've set out to find out. While Fiesta was being developed, Ford held a series of design clinics at which members of the public were asked to compare prototype Fiestas with the cars Ford saw as their fiercest rivals, the Fiat 127, the Renault 5, and the Volkswagen Polo. Now comes the drive-in clinic. We've taken the same four cars, we've brought them together with a group of car buyers, all of whom are in the market for a car in this class. We're giving our buyers the chance to drive all the cars and to question the salesman that each manufacturer has provided. And at the end of the day, they will declare which of the cars, if any, they would buy. First then, the cars.
We'll start with Ford. It's more expensive than most of the pundits had predicted. This model, the 957L, is £2,079. That includes items like seat belts, carpets and adjustable backrests. The Fiesta's 957cc engine is available in either high or low compression form, depending on whether your priority is on performance or economy. This is the high compression version. It's mounted transversely and drives the front wheels. In this group, only the Renault's engine runs north-south. There is, of course, a third door or hatch at the back, another important feature that all these cars share. The Volkswagen Polo was launched when the Fiesta's development had reached an advanced stage. Up to then, Ford had treated the Fiat 127 as its main competitor, but that assessment changed when the Polo came out. This is the basic N model, price £1,999. The engine is 895cc, smaller than the Fiestas, and 5 brake horsepower less powerful. It will, however, run on 2-star petrol. Standard equipment includes electric screen washers, parking and reversing lights. The Polo needs servicing less frequently than the others. VW recommend a service every 10,000 miles. Ford, Renault and Fiat stick to 6,000 miles. The Renault has the most distinctive styling. This model, the TL, sells for £2,106. It has a 903cc engine and, like the others, is front-wheel drive. Again, like the others, the rear door opens and the rear seat folds flat, is state car style. All four cars have a heated rear window as standard. The Renault is slightly less well-equipped than its rivals. Like the Polo, it has rubber mats rather than carpets. You do get an electric screen wash, though. Finally, the Fiat. It's the oldest design, and thanks to that and the fact that the lira is as sickly as sterling, it's the cheapest of the four. This version, the three-door special, costs £1,898. That, incidentally, makes it the most expensive model in the Fiat 127 range. With items like carpets, cigarette lighter, and a switch to work the wipers intermittently, all standard equipment. It's the biggest car in the group. It's also the only one without fascia fresh air vents. The 127 is powered by a 956cc engine, and like the others, has a 4-speed gearbox, front disc brakes, and a dual circuit braking system for safety. Well, so much for the cars. Now let's meet our customers. Linda Lee lives in London. She's 25, single, and works as a cashier in a West End casino. At the moment, she's running a 1968 Cortina 1600, which she finds too thirsty and awkward to park. She likes hatchbacks for their looks and wants her new car to be economical and easy to run around town.
I've got a pen, and that is the seat, which is child's buckles and things like that.
Yeah.
And you can see it comes without any mark whatsoever.
37-year-old Richard Hewell recently returned to this country after living abroad. Now he's just become a partner in a new company carrying out market research in the travel industry. He does a high mileage, generally between 25 and 30,000 miles a year. He's presently running an MGB. His requirements? A car that will carry all his personal and business belongings and which will do long distances, many of them in Europe, with the minimum of attention.
Travelling through Europe, one gets a whole range of different sorts of petrol and different grades of petrol. Would the motor suffer by constant change of 2-star, 3-star, different manufacturers of petrol?
No, not at all. It is in fact designed to run on 2-star petrol, which is the most common throughout Europe.
32.
Now a married couple, the Carters from Romford. Bob's 39 and a post office engineer. Elizabeth is a teacher. They have two cars at the moment, a Sunbeam Imp and a Morris 1000. But they are planning to trade both of them in when they get their new car. Incidentally, the only rule today is that the buyers can't negotiate discounts on the new cars or any part exchange deals on their old ones. Elizabeth Carter wants a car to get her to school each day. Bob wants one to take him golfing at weekends and for family holidays.
Boxes and all the odds and ends which sometime one needs to carry.
Absolutely. And also it's quite a low loading platform there.
Finally, a family, Graham and Sue Jex from St Albans, and their children, Claire, who's 7, and Mark, who's 5. Graham's 35, he's an architect. Although he occasionally uses his car for work, he's got a 10-year-old Singer Chamois, the Jex car is really strictly for family use, including holidays.
I see. And that, can that be easily released when the back of the seat is folded down for a passenger, for a luggage compartment?
Yes, it was designed particularly with this sort of conversion in mind.
Well, it's at this point that the buyers are going to take to the road and give each car a brief test.
I found the ride of the Renault overall probably the most comfortable of the four cars. My criticism would be that the gearbox was a bit like stirring porridge.
Well, I must admit that I was rather disappointed in the Volkswagen Polo. It's had a lot of publicity, and I was expecting a better performance from the car than I did actually get. I found there was a lot of play on the steering, which I did tend to correct as I drove the car more. But apart from this, the brakes seemed spongy and I didn't feel particularly safe driving the car.
The Fiesta, I liked the driving position very much indeed. It was very comfortable. I wanted to drive it fast. It was very comfortable, very relaxing. I think probably the best of the cars to drive.
The 127 is very pleasant to drive. The engine is noisy. The gear lever is very notchy and difficult to engage. Both of us had difficulty in getting it into gears at times.
Yes, I did find the Renault 5 very easy to park. It had great manoeuvrability. But the thing I didn't like about the Renault 5 was the gearbox felt very spongy, and also it was very sparse inside. Although the seats are very comfortable, and I think that on a long journey up the motorway, for example, it would stay comfortable all the time.
I think the Polo was very nice, very quiet, handled very well, and I really enjoyed driving it. The best of the lot, really.
The Ford Fiesta was an easy car to drive. It had easy gears, good all-round vision. I particularly liked the windscreen at the back, which kept your views clear at all times.
I found the 127's performance most lively, particularly through the gears. The noise level of the engine I found rather disturbing and rather raucous at top speeds, what would be cruising speeds on a motorway.
There's one more stage to go in the driving clinic before we ask the buyers to commit themselves to one or to none of the cars. They've inspected the cars, they've road tested them. Now we're giving them a final session with the salesman.
Can you tell me the cost of the extras over the list price in order to get the car onto the road?
Yep. Taking the 5TL, which is this particular model, you have first of all the inertia rear seatbelts, which are around about £33 extra.
Yes.
The cloth trim, which is £30 extra as well. And the floor gear change, which is, again, about £30.
I see. And if we wanted a rear wash wipe on the car, how much would that be as an extra?
Well, let me first say that, of course, it is standard on the 5 GTL and the 5 TS. If you wanted it as an extra on this car, you'd have to purchase it from our Renault Boutique, which is our accessory side, and it would be around about £30 to £35.
I believe that Fiat have improved the rust-proofing on their cars in the last few years. Is the bodywork still included in the guarantee?
Well, we are. We're rather fortunate with Fiat. They do have 2 years guarantee, which covers not only the paint, but all the panels, chassis, subframe. And it is, as you say, guaranteed for completely 2 years. Mm. And we think that's quite an achievement on our Fiat products.
And the underseal, is that included in the basic price or is that extra?
There's no extra charge for the underseal whatsoever.
Okay.
This is rather unusual. I don't think any other manufacturer actually has a 2 years guarantee on their underseal.
And what about the service? How many miles can the car do without a basic service?
It's 6,000 mile service.
6,000.
We've been driving in conditions where some of the cars have been misting up inside a lot. Yes. Is there anything that can combat it?
Yes, in the Polo, in actual fact, when you demist a windscreen from the vents at the front, you also have the outlets on the side of the dashboard, which allow demisting of the side windows, so in fact you don't get the condensation build-up along the side windows. And that, in conjunction with the heated rear window, means basically you have a clear field of vision all the way around the motor car.
Is that fan-assisted?
It is booster-assisted, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. It is the same system as the demisting of the windscreen. So it is on the twin-speed fan boost as well, yes.
Boost it up.
But, for example, in many cars, if you want to buy the larger engine, you have to buy completely different motor cars or deluxe version.
Right.
On this one, can you have the 1100 engine with the basic model?
You can indeed. In fact, on this particular model, which is the L version, you can have all three engines, the 950 low compression, the 950 high compression, or indeed the 1117. Depends, obviously, whether you want to go to the performance or the economy.
Yes. If, for example, you put in the 1100 engine, can one have the extras, for example, the rear windscreen wiper, which I think is quite vital on this, and maybe a lockable glove box?
Right. We do over 20 options on all the range of cars, but, for instance, the lockable glove box will not come as a standard feature until you get to the best of the range, which is the gear.
Well, as Huey would say, it's make your mind up time, friends, and I mean that most sincerely. Let's turn to our four amateur testers and ask them what they think. Linda Lee, will you join me over here for a second, love? What's your choice of the four cars?
Well, my choice has got to be the Fiat 127.
The Fiat 127, now why'd you go for that?
Because it's got everything in the basic price. The basic car has got radio, headrest, carpets, everything, and it's an economical car, good-looking car.
And the basic price attracts you?
Yes.
All right, my love, thank you very much. Okay. Let's ask Mr. Hewell to come over here. Mr. Hewell, what's your choice of car?
Well, I find it rather difficult between two, really. Mm-hmm.
Which are you torn between?
The Volkswagen and the Fiesta.
Yeah.
Both I found the most interesting to drive, but probably a difference in seating comfort would make the Fiesta a choice. But in fact, for economy of running, the two-star petrol and the length of servicing, I would go for the Volkswagen.
So if you could afford it, you'd have both of them, would you?
Exactly.
All right, Mr. Hewell. Thank you very much. What are the Carters? A family choice here or not? Mr. Carter?
Yes, agreement between us. We both like the Renault 5.
Why do you go for the Renault?
The comfort of the ride.
Comfort of the ride. It's, do you feel the same way, Mrs. Garden?
Well, I think it's going to suit us for town riding and for long journeys, which we hope to do.
That's absolutely fantastic. All right, good luck to you. Thank you very much for coming into our test. And finally, a whole family of testers, the Jexies. Will you join me over here? Mrs. Jex, let me get your reaction first of all. Which do you go for?
Well, we're torn between two, the Polo and the Fiesta.
What do you like about each?
Well, I prefer the driving the Polo, but I think for economy-wise, the Fiesta's probably better.
Which makes me suspect that your husband fancies the Fiesta, is that so?
Yes, I was won over by the Fiesta.
What do you like about that?
I liked the cost of maintenance, I thought, was low, and therefore that appealed to me a great deal. And the rear sill was certainly a very useful feature.
Thank you for your help. That really is the most extraordinary result. They've gone for one car each right across the range, and I promise you, you'll have to take my word for this, there was no connivance, they didn't get together on it at all. That was their choice without any discussion whatsoever. I think it does say congratulations to those salesmen as well, don't you?